So the next item of asset is non-banking assets acquired in satisfaction of clients. Suppose the bank is giving a loan against mortgage of a building, and that becomes NPA, it means borrower is not paid in time. Now through SARFAESI action, bank can bring this building for action. If no bidders are coming, the bank themselves can take it and own it. But there are some restrictions as per Banking Regulation Act. They cannot own it forever, but they have to sell it again in the market. And if they are not selling it, it should be converted into your, at least for a branch purpose. This is what the Banking Regulation Act says. So again, to repeat, items under this account include immovable properties, tangible assets which are acquired by the bank in satisfaction of bank's claim or others. Then coming to other items could include clearing entries, unresolved claim entries, unreconciled entries or forging other item, and any asset which is not forming part of the discussion which I said, fixed assets or whatever you can know, this which is not having the capacity or character to be bought there, it will go within other item. Next, we are going to a thing called contingent liabilities. Contingent liabilities will not form part of balance sheet. They are called as non-fund based exposures or off-balance sheet exposures. I give retrospective, I give bank guarantees, or I give derivatives. These are all called contingent liabilities because the day on the letter of guarantee is issued, there is not any commitment, and it depends on the future commitment of the customer. If a customer fails to pay, then the results may have commitment. To read the PowerPoint, banks are sanctioning several non-funded credit facilities such as letter of credit, letter of guarantees, sometimes it's called bank guarantees. This letter of credit can be performance guarantees or it can be financial guarantees. Performance guarantees backed by some performance. I give a letter of guarantee for construction of a road bridge, then it depends on the performance of constructing the bridge. Financial guarantees are simple money payments. Previously, RBI never used to offer financial guarantees. Now RBI permitting after liberalization, financial guarantees are also permitted. Then the third item of guarantees, deferred payment guarantees. That is, deferred payment guarantees are guarantees commitments which are payable to a customer on an installment basis. Is the giving the term loan, I am asking the supplier of tractor to give that tractor, and the EMIs are guaranteed by me. Whenever the EMIs are not paid by the borrower, then the bank has to step in and pay. The another class is called derivatives. Derivatives, by definition, derivatives are those instruments which derives its value from the underlying exposure. Suppose an exporter is there, he has got a lot of receivables, dollar receivables are there. If rupee is appreciating, suppose let us think that today $1.61, and there is apprehension that in future the dollar may go to 55 rupees, it means if I convert dollar today I get 61 rupees, by third month or second month I am going to get less rupee. So this can be hedged by taking a forward contract from the bank. So derivatives can be forward contract, or it can be interest rate swap, or it can be forward rate agreement, and recently RBI funded credit default swaps. These are all called derivatives. And the day on which the derivatives are issued, there are no commitments, and if my customer is not meeting the commitment by due date, there will be follow-up flow. So derivatives can be forward contracts, options, etc. These facilities, on day on which banks give the commitment, there is no follow-up flow, but has the potential to create follow-up flow whenever the customer fails to honor his commitment. Bank itself would be groping in thought, because when I give a letter of guarantee, letter of credit, I don't know after 6 months or 3 months my customer will meet it or not. That's why I am groping in thought whether he will meet it or not. If he is not meeting, that's a fund flow for the banks. So bank itself would be groping in thought when such clients would materialize. So on the date of contract, this instrument would not form part of the balance sheet. It will not occupy the balance sheet, and these items are mentioned as footnotes to the balance sheet. But the day on which they crystallize, they become funded exposure, it will be the internal balance sheet or asset side, and become funded exposures and form part of the asset side of the balance sheet. Now, having seen the components, now we have seen on the liability side, what are the components? On the asset side is one of the components. Now any balance sheet, it should be supported by a profit and loss account. From profit and loss account only I come to know year end whether the bank has made a profit or it has made a loss. Then these statements are called financial statements. The investor comes to know, the stakeholder comes to know that my bank is in profit or my bank is in loss. So such a statement is called profit and loss account. They are called twin brothers, balance sheet and profit and loss account. We already discussed what is the balance sheet. Now we are going to discuss what is profit and loss account. In short, a profit and loss account is called as P&L account. A bank's P&L account has the following two components. One component will be expenditure, another component will be income. Like balance sheet, assets and liabilities, the assets in P&L becomes income, the liability becomes an expenditure. Now let us move on to discuss P&L subcomponents. The first item is income. Income which mainly includes interest and other income. The most of the income, chunk of the income for the bank comes from advances. They give advance from that the interest income comes. That's why it's called interest income from advances. On the expenditure side, chunk of the expenditure is interest paid on deposits. So naturally, if you net the income received and income paid, there should be a surplus that is called as the interest income. The expenditure which includes interest expended, provisions and contingencies, and operating expenses. So the first item on expenditure is interest paid on deposits. The next item is provisions and contingencies. Not only banks have to keep a lot of provisions, which we discuss afterwards. And operating expense is nothing but administrative expenses like salaries, rent paid and all that. Let us first discuss the subcomponents of the head income. Income is broadly classified as interest income, other income, or it's also called as interest income, non-interest income. Now let us take first interest income. In fact, this head is the major breadwinner for the bank. This if this interest income becomes negative, that is after payment of my deposit, then the bank is in loss. That's why it is a major breadwinner for the bank. So, in fact, this head is the major breadwinner for the bank, and the bank thrives on this income as spread is essentially generation from this head. Interest stroke discount or advances in this. Particularly discounts out of discounting and purchasing the bill. When I purchase the bill, if the bill is due today, then for side bills, the bank purchases, whereas for future bills, remembering that we are in November and I am purchasing January 2014, I use the word discounting the bill. If today is a on demand bill, then you use the word purchasing the bill. So, interest for discount on advance bills. This item includes interest and discount on all types of loans and advances like tax credit, demand loans, overdraft, term loans, export advances, domestic and foreign goods purchase and discounted, overdue interest and interest subsidy. If it means this includes all payment of interest received from advances, bills, etc. Then comes income on investment. As I told you already, bank parks lot of funds in government securities. They also park funds in commercial papers and all that. So periodically they get interest from government or they get interest from the corporates. So these incomes are credited here. The interest received are coupon yielding securities and the dividend earned. Sometimes they are permitted to trade on shares also. So the any share we get dividend, on any coupon yielding we get interest. So the interest received are coupon yielding securities and the dividend earned on shares are the main income under this head. Then the third item is interest income, then interest in discount on advance bills. The third item is income on investments. It means interest received on, that we have discussed, interest earned on interbank funds. So this is nothing but when I got a surplus fund, then I lend in call. Or I got a surplus fund, I lend to CDLO. So that items your interest. This is from the income earned by corporate lending, CDLO lending, etc. Then any other income which cannot be grouped under the above is taken to other income or sundry income. All other types of interest, so discount income that cannot be included in the above head would appear in this head. So far what we have discussed is the bank getting interest from the advances given. That's what is called as interest income. Now Now we are going to discuss how the interest is going to come from non-interest portfolio. That's why it's called non-interest income. They are grouped under other income. A part of interest income backs a certain income in the form of commission, exchange, fees, etc., which are derived in the following ways. Normally, commission we charge on issuing letter of guarantee or letter of credit. All these things are commission. It represents interest in you. It means when I give as advance, it becomes an interest. When I give as non-funded exposure, the same interest component becomes a commission. And where the exchange comes? The exchange normally comes in case of foreign exchange because bankers normally convert foreign currency rupee into foreign currencies. So an exporter, when the exporter is giving the foreign currency, the currency is converted into rupee. Like that, an importer, the rupee is converted into foreign currency. So every conversion, the margin is lower. This margin is called exchange. Bank runs exchange by giving foreign exchange rates to exporters and importer price. This exchange margin is loaded with the rate. So it means in case of foreign exchange transaction, I never collect the commission or interest separately. In the rate quoted to the customer or merchant, the bank's margin is loaded. Brokerage, when banks are selling the life, non-life now, banks are permitted to do their business. They can act as brokers, they can act as agents. In the process of selling these life policies, non-life policies, they get fees, they are called as brokerage. Fees like that, one of the very good area for the banks are safe deposit lockers. When lockers are given, they collect fees from the depositors or the customers, so they are credited to the head called fees. So non-interest income can be credited to commission, it can be credited to exchange, or it can be credited to brokerage, or it can be credited to fees account. Now, next item is profit on sale of investments. So like that I told you, banks are parking their funds in government securities, they are parking in corporate bonds, they are parking in commercial papers and all that. So when they sell it on the due date, there is no problem, you get the face value of the bond. But when the urgency and exigency comes, these bonds or securities are be offloaded or sold in the secondary market. When they sell in the secondary market, they may not get the face value. Depending on the market movement or depending on the interest rate movements, they will get either above the face value or less than the face value. For example, if you take interest on the interest on a bond and the price of the bond, it has got an inverse relationship. When the interest rate goes, the price falls, and the interest rate comes down, the price goes up. Suppose everything that a bank purchases a 10-year security at 10%, then after purchase of the security, say within the next time, the interest rate comes down, on the secondary market, this bond can be sold at a profit. Same way, conversely, now the bank has purchased the 10-year security at 10%, after 1 week or 10 days, the interest rate comes down, they can sell it a profit, the interest rate goes up, it will be sold at a loss. So in the ripple, bank mostly invests in government securities, though do not carry credit risk, they carry market risk. Because by definition, government securities, the investment government securities are called as sovereign risk. It means zero risk. I don't get any credit risk, I'm sure of getting my principal. But because of the interest rate movements, I don't run credit risk, I run market risk. In both this, depending on the interest rate movements, whenever bank wants to buy or sell the securities from the secondary market, they may not be able to buy or sell the sale on par value or face value. The secondary market prices may be higher or lower than the face value of the bond, depending on the interest rate movement, and the cost of buying or selling the same, bank may incur loss or profit taking into account the face value of the bond. If it results in profit, then this is credited to the head called profit on sale of investment. If it results in loss, it will be debited to the loss account. But here then, this account will be either profit or loss that will be netted, and if it shows a credit balance, it is called credit or profit, and if it shows a debit balance, it is called loss. Then, next item of income is profit on revaluation of investments. Banks invest in foreign bonds, banks invest in local bonds also. Foreign bonds means they are kept in foreign currency. and it has to be translated periodically. That is how much balance sheet was in 3 months, say in June, September, December, March. So these bonds, even though it is falling into 5 years from now, but every three months, it has been translated. I'm holding a dollar bond kind of thing. So dollar bond, it has been translated and it is reported in the balance sheet. On the date of translation, this translation there is given by FEDA. FEDA means foreign exchange. FEDA is one of the subsidiaries that is working under the control of RBI. So this FEDA is observed with daily rates. So these bonds have been translated on ongoing rates. By converting the rates, it may result in profit or it may result in loss depending on the holding price of the bond. If it results in profit, it will be greater to profit on revaluation of investments. Same way, domestic bonds also independent revalue, it may result in profit or it may result in loss. As I told you, subsequent to the purchase of the bond, if interest rate falls, such revaluation will result in profit, and if the interest rate goes up, that will result in loss. The other gains, that is arising out of revaluation of foreign bond or arising out of interest rate moves of domestic bond, if results in profit, it will be credited to profit on revaluation of investments. Then profit on sale of assets. I told you banks are making a lot of fixed assets, assets in the form of branch premises, motor car, and all these things. Periodically these assets have to be replaced, particularly movable assets like car and all that. When it is worn out, it is sold. At the time of sale, if it results in profit, it will be credited to this profit on sale of assets. Or if branch wants to move the premises, it has to sell the premises, that premises can result, the sale can result in profit. So any item which cannot be grouped under above the income will be credited to miscellaneous income account. Banks get income from several sources. Income which cannot be parked in the other head could be parked in this head. Recovery of loan rent, recovery of rent on the furniture provided, offices, etc. will be credited to this miscellaneous income. Now we have dealt at length the income. Now we are moving on to the side called expenditure. What are the various expenditure the bank is incurring? Now let us move on the expenditure side. The expenditure of the bank can be broadly classified into interest expense, provision discounted contingencies, and other operating expenses. So for discussion, let us take first what is interest expenditure. Interest expenditure, as told already, it is interest paid on deposits. This represents interest paid on deposits, both savings and term deposits. Now savings bank, most of the banks pay at 4%, it is deregulated, even though most of them who fall in majority, they pay 4% on daily product basis. In case of term deposit, it is paid for the period that deposits in the bank. This is the biggest expenditure of the bank. On the side of income, the biggest income is interest received on advances. On the side of expenditure, it is interest paid on deposits. If it is a going concern, naturally the income received on advances will be more than the interest paid on advances. The balance amount represents net interest income. So if interest expenditure we see, the next is interest on borrowings. Interest on borrowings is, suppose the bank falls short of money, their outflows are more than inflows, then they go and borrow in government. So when they borrow from government from other banks, naturally they have to be interest rate. So this becomes an expenditure. Like that, bank can borrow through repo window. Or repo window is a window by which RBI provides liquidity to the bank, for which the bank has to pay a rate of interest. So that's called, they can borrow through CBO borrowings also. All this becomes expenditure, that's why it's called interest on borrowings. The third item which cannot be again interest item only, which cannot be grouped under interest expenditure, interest borrowings, this will be grouped under other interest payable account. It's called, this may include interest paid on refinance, we can go there, banks can take refinance to export refinance to RBI and other finance institutions and sundry interest paid. Then we will move on to the next thing called provisions and contingencies. Your bank has to keep a lot of provisions. Like if you buy a fixed assets, I keep provision of depreciation. Depreciation is not a cash outflow, thus cash remains within the system. So it means I debit depreciation and I don't pay anybody, and it remains within the system. That's why these provisions in contingencies, even though it is debited to the P&L account, to that account there is no money outflow, the money outflow lies within the system. What are the ways where are the banks are required to keep provisions and contingencies? Banks have to create provisions as per RBI norms, and this includes a bank has to create a provision on standard assets. There are different forms of standard assets, how much they have to keep, and most of the items are 0.40% on non-priority advances like that. Provision cost of standard and doubtful loans, provision for diminution value of securities, provision made future payment gratuity and other benefits of employees, and provision for taxation. These are the provisions and contingencies. We have seen on the expenditure side for these interest paid on deposits. Next we have seen provisions and contingencies. The third interest item is operating expenses. So operating expenses normally consist of all the administrative expenses of the bank. So the biggest one actually will be salaries paid to the employees. So payment of salaries, stock salaries, allowance expenses, other stock benefits like provident fund, gratuity, leave at concession, stock welfare, medical expenses, or dividend. This is cost of the company, what this one they say. So all these things are coming in there under this head. Next is, if banks are taking the permits on leave, naturally they have to pay rent. And again, as I told you, they have to pay taxes because they are part of income tax, they are part of service tax, all these taxes are paid here, and they use electricity, so they have to pay electricity bill. So a rent paid by the bank, hiring rental buildings, municipal taxes paid, electricity taxes paid, or all group level is set. The next item is for printing and stationery. I told you they maintain a lot of stationeries. Banking expenditure on check writing, checkbook printing is a big one, and particularly with the CTS 2010, they use all standardized formats. The cost of check is very, very high, printing of check is very high because the quality of the paper, it has to go through your all your electronic gadgets. That's why this CTS 2010 checks are costly. The banks incur expenditure on check printing, computer stationery, security forms like loan agreements. For any loans, the hypothecation agreement, bank check agreement, assignment agreement, many things are there. So these are the agreement forms which they have to enter with the borrowers. With the introduction of computer, many records are now kept in database, and as a result, keeping hard copies are come down. It means the paper stocking is coming down, instead it is kept on the database. Next item is advertisement and publicity. With the liberalization, yes, there is healthy growth between the banks. The healthy growth of the bank leads to advertisement. They have to compete with each other. So next day they come out with advertisement and publicity, bills or secrets, all these things involves expenditure. All the banks are incurring good amount of expenditure nowadays. This is one of the marketing effort, and potential customers are attracted by good advertisement. And the third item is for depreciation of bank property. I told you banks are maintaining motor car and all that. There is a wear and tear, and it has to be debited to their depreciation account. We have seen on the asset side of the balance sheet, banks is owning number of assets like premises, furniture, motor cars, safe deposit lockers, and computers, all these things. Particularly computer, the wear and tear is small. That's why as per income tax, banks are permitted to write off depreciation rate of 33.13 on straight line method. So the depreciation charge may be on computer, there are other items, it is not 33, it will be ranging from 10 to 15%, and therefore the return down with the value. Then director fees, allowance and expenses. Any bank, it has got the supreme power bank is board of directors. The board of directors consists, the board consists of directors, and there are board meetings, the directors come, their sitting fees are paid for them. So directors, fees, allowances, expenses are taken care and it is grouped under this expenditure. Then we move on to the expected expenditure called audit fees and expenses. Nowadays, if we take branch, some kind of audit is going on. It can be statutory audit, it can be concurrent audit, or it can be stock audit, or it can be some regular audits are keeping, particularly for special type of branches like treasury or other branches, specialized branches, international payment branches, the auditors are always there, concurrent audit is always attached to them. So these fees, particularly fees paid to statutory audit, branch audit, concurrent audit are part of the share. Then comes law charges. Law charges means every bank has got their own panel of advocate. They give opinion on the documents, they give opinion on the mortgages, and all these advocates have been paid. So these charges are paid in the debit of non-charges. Then comes postal charges, nowadays postal, most of the banks, they never use. It is, the usage is coming down, it's retail delivery charges. So this is postal expenses for sending the calls of the banks. Then comes repairs and maintenance, because it will be a fixed asset, it has to maintain, it has to maintain internally. So for maintenance, definitely it involves expenditure, it has to be upkeep, the upkeep of fixed assets, all these expenditure are debited to repairs and maintenance. Then insurance, yes, bank maintains fixed assets, they keep cash in at the vault, then they have to move the cash to cash chest. All these things has to be protected to insurance. A fixed asset, I pay insurance, banks pay insurance. And for cash transit, they pay insurance. For holding the cash in the branch, they pay insurance. For holding the cash deal with the cashier, they pay insurance. So all these insurance expenses. And but again, for export advances, it is covered by ECDC guarantee. For MSME advances, it is covered by CGT, MSE, corporate guarantees. All these, and again, all deposits, the banks have to pay guarantee to the deposit insurance corporation. It means any failure of the bank, liquidation of the bank, then the deposit insurance corporation use 1 lakh per bank for the depositors. This insurance is also borne by the bank. All these insurance fees are debited to the state. Then finally, other expenditure. And then other expenditure means the expenditure, leaving the interest expenditure, the remaining which cannot be controlled, non-interest income, non-interest expenditure which cannot be controlled, will be controlled under other expenditure. Other expenditure like license fee, donations, banks are permitted to give a percentage of their profit or something like that. They can pay donations, subscriptions to papers, periodicals, entertainment expenses, travel expenses are included under the sale. So, with this module, we are completing the components of the balance sheet. We have looked at length, what is assets, what is liabilities, and it is supported with profit and loss account. On the expenditure side, what are subcomponents? On the income side, what are subcomponents? If income is exceeding the expenditure, naturally, the bank results in a profit.